So without further ado, we have once again three fabulous participants today. And we're going to start off with Shehara Mendis. So Shehara is one of our rising star medical oncologists who has come to work at Cabrini and has a particular interest in gastrointestinal cancers, both upper and lower. So Shehara trained at St. Vincent's and then went on and did her specialist training and worked at a number of hospitals, including being my registrar at Cabrini, where she did a tremendous job, and that's why we're very happy to have her back. After going to complete her training in Melbourne, she went over to Vancouver to work, and we're going to talk to her in some detail about that, and then has come back to Melbourne and is working at the WEHI and also at Cabrini. So welcome, Shehara.
I'm a dying breed now in that I was an undergraduate medical student. There's fewer and fewer places for undergrad medical students, and that's all more postgrad. So I kind of muddled through med school in my late teen years and early 20s. And I knew, I'm sorry, Paul McMurrick, I had not a surgical bone in my body. And I was either going to do something physician training or something similar like that. And as I went through my internship and then basic physician training, I sort of slowly cut out other specialties. And so I think in medicine, a lot of people go, I knew from the day I stepped into med school, I wanted to be an orthopedic surgeon or an intensivist or this or that. And for me, it was a bit of a slow burn, a bit of a slower process. And as I went through my physician training and did a lot more oncology, had a lot more oncology exposure, I came to have a great respect for the patients that you look after and the nuances of treating them and the relationship you have with them, and saw myself hopefully being one of those consultants I looked up to. And so I crafted my basic physician training years to include more oncology, and then ultimately went through an advanced training. And I think it was really the patients that brought me to oncology, but I've stayed for the company as well as the other career opportunities that include research. Sorry, Gary, my Wi-Fi cut out for a second. The question was what brought me towards research?
Yes.
It's a good question. Again, at the start of my medical training and medical career, I couldn't have told you that I wanted to be a researcher, but I sort of think back now, and I had a year of research as a Bachelor of Medical Sciences during my undergrad year. And that probably unknowingly sowed the seeds for ongoing future research. And while there was quite a pause in my research output or efforts during my basic physician advanced training years, I had the opportunity to do some research while I was completing my oncology training. And the ability to do something that was completely outside the clinical sphere that potentially had an impact on a broader scientific and clinical community really drew me to it. And, you know, it's intellectually, it's very satisfying to be able to look at some really difficult questions and start to take what seem like really small, tiny steps towards ultimately, hopefully, big long-term goals and gains. And so research for me provides a really interesting kind of intellectual avenue, but also there's a bit of philanthropy there, because ultimately we're all trying to make the place we live in better and make the care that we give to our patients better.
Beautiful. Now, you had the opportunity to go overseas and work in Vancouver. So can you tell us about that and tell us in detail about the research that you did over there?
I did, while I was doing a clinical fellowship here at the Western, at Western Hospital, where I was involved in the clinical trials, I was able to see kind of the research output that you can do as a clinician researcher. I saw that it was a good opportunity at that point in my career to go overseas and look at how a different country did things and learn some additional skills, and also really kind of drill down into more research, not just within the clinical sphere, but also to be involved in some translational research. So I went over in mid-2018 and worked with the gastrointestinal oncologists over in Vancouver. And there were three or four of them, and they all kind of had their tumour stream expertise. And I worked with Dr. Daniel Renoff, who runs the Pancreas Centre BC, which has very strong translational output because they have a whole genome sequencing program at BC Cancer. And I was able to work with Dr. Laurie, who I still now work with and do research with, who does a mix of clinical outcomes research and translational research in colorectal cancer. And so those 18 months in Vancouver were really phenomenal for me from a research perspective, because I was able to spend quite a lot of my week focusing on research. And that was really helpful for me to focus where my areas of interest were. And they still remain fairly broad, but I was able to kind of craft some really interesting expertise with regards to whole genome sequencing and translational work using circulating tumor DNA, as well as also look more broadly at quality assurance in clinical trials, and look at whether, you know, there's appropriate representation of men and women in clinical trials that lead to drug approvals. I could probably go on, but it's kind of the breadth of what I did there. And so that was really great, because until I'd gone to Vancouver, I hadn't really had that opportunity to be part of a unit that had that sort of expertise. A lot of my research experience had been purely clinical, and this added a feather to my cap in terms of being allowing me to be part of a more scientific and translational based research group. And it allowed me the opportunity to put a lot of time into developing papers, writing papers, and getting them published, which I really hadn't had the opportunity to do before I went there. So it helped me focus.
What were some of the findings that you published?
So some of the findings that we published with regards to translational research, we were looking at BRAF V600 mutant colorectal cancer. So the background is, in colorectal cancer, there's multiple kind of molecular subtypes. The BRAF mutant colorectal cancers are notoriously bad, but everyone, when they say BRAF, they're thinking about BRAF V600 mutations. There's actually a whole lot of other mutations that you can have, and they're far less common. They're kind of the 1-2% of metastatic colorectal cancer. And those atypical BRAF mutations actually have quite a very distinct kind of clinical trajectory to the standard BRAF mutant colorectal cancers. And we were able to track their progress using circulating tumor DNA, and also demonstrate how tumor evolution can occur with treatment sequencing, and how that can impact on the effectiveness of your ctDNA, or the readability of your ctDNA results. I also was involved in a bit of neuroendocrine research, and we looked at the use of octreotide and lanreotide over time. And interestingly, we found that lanreotide seemed to be quite a lot more effective than octreotide in terms of controlling the classic carcinoid symptoms you associate with neuroendocrine tumors. And then the thing I most recently published, which is completely different to that, was to do with sex disparity in clinical trials. And we're finding that even in more contemporaneous trials, so trials that have been read out in the past 10 or 12 years, we're still under enrolling women, particularly in solid organ trials and particularly in GI cancer trials. So I feel like I'm in a good place to try and help change that. And we weren't able to go into the reasons for that. But it was kind of really interesting to see that disparity still exists, and it probably all relates to care responsibilities and other social determinants of health because this research was done in particularly in a US setting where, you know, your health insurance status really impacts your ability to access good treatment. So that's a bit of the breadth of what I've done.
Right. Okay. And do you think that disparity exists in Australia as well, particularly the male to female? As I gather that colorectal cancer is pretty much balanced between men and women.
Yeah. It's a really good question, and it's something I'd be keen to look into. Because we have a different healthcare system in that everyone has, you know, Medicare access, I think that there will be some differences between what you find in a US population versus what you find in an Australian population. But I think the fact that sex is a social determinant of health is kind of uniform and a global issue. And while it might affect us less here, I suspect we'd probably still find similarities with the under-enrollment of women. I didn't publish on it, but I went and had a look at the IDEA trial, which was the adjuvant trial of colorectal cancer, which enrolled 12,000 people. And Australians were big contributors to that trial. And even that trial, which is very, very recent, under-enrolled women. And so Australians are contributing to that trial. So I suspect we still have a gap to fill. And you have to find the gap to know that you've got to fill it.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
So since you left Vancouver and came home, what have you been up to?
I should have mentioned, while I was in Vancouver doing all of that research, I started a master's and I was completing that while I was overseas. So I came back and completed that last year. And as part of that master's, I was doing a project looking at screen-detected versus non-screen-detected colorectal cancer. And that was presented at ASCO GI this year virtually. And basically we're showing that, first of all, screen-detected cancers, patients with screen-detected colorectal cancers have a better survival than non-screen-detected or symptomatically presented colorectal cancer, and that's pretty obvious. But what we were able to do was look at survival stage for stage. So if you compare a stage B screen-detected colorectal cancer with a stage B non-screen-detected colorectal cancer, the screen-detected colorectal cancers are still doing better stage for stage. So there's a bit more than just stage migration that's accounting for that survival benefit. And some of that relates to the patient population, but there'll be other factors as well to do with the growth of the tumour over time.
Okay.
Yeah. And so then the other, probably the most important thing I should mention that I've been doing since coming back is working on building an upper GI database here at Cabrini. So with your support, thank you very much, Gary, and support of Sharon, who I'm not sure if she's on the line today, we've been developing a database, a very comprehensive one, that we're hoping to capture all upper GI patients from esophagus through to gastric, through to hepatocellular, etc., to really track the patients we're caring for at Cabrini, to track the treatment they receive and their outcomes, and to have a really strong kind of base on which to build future research from.
Fantastic. So I know that you are also working with the Department of Surgery with Paul McMurrick and his group, and one of the things that I was very keen to do in our research at Cabrini was to break down some of the silos so that we had much more cross-fertilisation, I guess, of research, and certainly medical oncology and colorectal cancer go together very well. So can you tell us a little bit about what you've been doing with Paul's work?
Yes, certainly. Thank you. First of all, I'd like to say thank you very much to Paul and the group for welcoming into their very well-established research department. They're all extremely established researchers, so, you know, I've got to make sure I pull my weight. And so I've been helping with expanding the organoid program. So Paul and Rebekah, you know, have been trailblazers along with the Monash group in terms of growing colorectal organoids, because that's a fairly difficult thing to do. And what I'm hoping to be able to bring is a clinical aspect to that, where we look at patients with colorectal cancer that have already had treatment, and we use the organoids to kind of project what future treatments would be most amenable to them. Because I think, you know, in as you yourself have said, you know, in 5 to 10 years' time, the oncology landscape will be very different. People will come in not just with their biopsy, they'll come in with their next generation sequencing results of their tumor, they'll come in with their extended germline testing panel, and we will really be individualizing treatment to a much greater level than we do now. And the organoid program is going to be instrumental in that, in terms of predicting what are going to be viable treatment options beyond what you learn through next generation sequencing, etc.
Fantastic. So just as the last piece of advice for everyone, tell us how, as a researcher and a mother and everything else you do, how do you manage your work-life balance?
So it's tricky. I was reading a blog by people who are more established and balancing similar roles. And I think of it as a pendulum. So there's a pendulum swing of, at some points in your life and your career, the pendulum swing towards work, and you're going to be doing the long hours or the weekends, like crunching out your 10,000 word thesis for your master's. But at other times, the pendulum will have to swing towards other things in your life, whether that's your clinical work or that's your family or that's a sick relative or whoever it is. And so you kind of can't judge your progress on a week. It's like research, it's a slow burn, and you sort of have to make sure that pendulum swings between them, and so you have balance in all aspects of your life and recognize that at different points in your life you can focus and be most effective at different things.
Very wise words. Well, thanks very much, Shehara, for sharing all that with us. That's been a great insight into a young and rising researcher, and we are very happy to have you working at Cabrini with us. So thank you very much.
Thank you. And I am absolutely flattered to be asked to talk at this early stage of my career. And I've got to say that research doesn't happen without good mentors such as yourself and Paul, and good teamwork with people like Rebekah and Simon and Christine. So thank you, everybody.
No worries. Thank you. And speaking of Rebekah, we'll now move on to our second presentation. Rebekah is a senior research officer in the Cabrini Monash University Department of Surgery. She has a PhD in immunology from the University of Queensland, where she investigated T cell control, persistent viral infections in humans. And she joined Cabrini, I think, in 2016. And her title of her talk today is Chemotherapy Resistance Associated with Upregulation of Revival Stem Cell Markers in Patient-Derived Colorectal Cancer Organoids. Over to you, Rebekah.
Today I'm presenting on a paper that we published with our collaborators down at the Monash BDI, Helen Abud and her group down there. This study was published last year in the Journal of Clinical Medicine. So I will just give some background to the study first. My computer's a bit slow. There we go. Many of you will be aware, we're a group that studies bowel cancer or colorectal cancer. So 1 in 13 Australians will develop bowel cancer in their lifetime. It's our third most commonly diagnosed and our second biggest cancer killer in Australia. So we know that if detected early, treatment for bowel cancer is very successful. However, more than 50% of patients are detected in late stage of disease. So patients who present with stage 4 or metastatic disease have just 13% chance of survival after 5 years. And so research in our department is really focused on how to improve outcomes for these patients. So many of you don't need the basic biology lesson, but just to cover off normal intestinal biology. So the intestine is the most highly regenerative organ in the human body, and it regenerates its lining, this lining here called the epithelium, every 5 to 7 days. And this regeneration is driven by the stem cells that reside in the base of the crypts. These are called the crypt-based columnar cells, or CBCs. And these produce progenitor or transit amplifying cells that go on to produce all of the different differentiated cell types of the epithelium. Recently, there was a unique stem population termed the revival stem cell that was identified in mice. So this revival stem cell pool is extremely rare under homeostatic or normal conditions, but are activated at the onset of tissue injury. And these cells repopulate the damaged intestinal crypts, including these crypt-based columnar stem cell population at the base of the crypt. So in the mouse study, these authors showed that this unique stem cell population, which is marked by the clusterin gene and labelled here in the red fluorescent TD tomato stain, is mobilised following radiation-induced intestinal damage. And its progeny will eventually replace all of the damaged cells of the epithelium. So we became interested in this newly identified stem cell population to investigate its role in a cancer context. But why are we interested in the role of stem cells in colorectal cancer? Well, we know that the expression levels of stem cell markers, what we term the stem cell signature, has been shown to be predictive of disease relapse in colorectal cancer. The data shown here from the battle group was examining normal intestinal stem cell genes, and they showed that high expression of these genes in the setting of colorectal cancer is associated with worse disease-free survival and an increase in the risk of relapse. So as this data suggests that stem cells can be associated with the initiation and relapse of the disease, we were really interested to see how the patient heterogeneity in normal intestinal stem cell signatures might contribute to drug resistance in the setting of colorectal cancer. So many of you may have heard me talk before, and you'd be familiar with the tumor organoid model that we use for our research. But for those of you who may not have seen me present before, or are not familiar with this concept, we grow these patient-derived tumoroids as a model for colorectal cancer. These are essentially miniaturized versions of a patient's own tumor that we can grow in the laboratory in this 3D formation, and we can grow up and have hundreds and thousands of these little miniaturized tumors. We know that they are able to recapitulate the features of the tissue from which they are derived, and we establish these from a small piece of tissue that we collect following surgical resection of the cancer. So they are a robust model for investigating cancer, and they allow us to do that on an individual patient level. So initially for this study, we performed some gene expression analysis looking at the different intestinal cell types in our colorectal cancer tumoroid lines. So this is our gene expression analysis, which was performed using quantitative PCR on 11 tumoroid lines, measuring the expression of stem cells, differentiated cell types, as well as expression of these markers associated with the new revival stem cell population. And these are shown in the middle here, and these are called clusterin and UNXA1. This is a very busy slide, and I don't intend for you to take in all of the data, but what it really shows is that there's a great variability in between individual stem cell signatures from our patients. It's a real heterogeneous expression patterns between each of the different patient lines. So our next question was whether the expression of these stem cell markers was associated with chemotherapeutic response. So using the tumoroids, we're able to mimic the treatment that patients receive in the clinic by treating the tumoroids in the lab with the same drugs that they would ordinarily receive. So here we have treated these six tumoroid lines with the chemotherapeutic drug 5-FU. We show an increasing dose of 5-FU along the x-axis and the measure of cell viability or cell death on the y-axis. And what we observe is that each patient line responds differently. That's what we expect to see, because that's what we expect, that's what we see in the patients as well. Important to note here is that there are more resistant lines. These ones on this end of the scale on the area under the curve analysis, 64 and 67T being more resistant to therapy as opposed to 54T, which was the most sensitive. So we wanted to determine whether the basal expression levels of stem cell markers that the data I just showed you was indeed predictive of drug resistance. And so to do this, we performed a linear regression analysis correlating gene expression analysis with the drug response, and that was as assessed by the area under the curve analysis. And what we showed, focusing probably just on this bottom left-hand graph here, is so there is a strong correlation between high area under the curve or resistance to treatment and high expression of clusterin. So as you can see on this plot, our most resistant organoids, 64T and 67T, also have the highest expression of clusterin. So this suggested to us that the revival stem cell may also have a role in chemo resistance. And interestingly, when we correlate this data back to our the data recorded on our patient database, we noted that both of these who were resistant to treatment in culture were also had gone on to have progressive disease. So following chemotherapeutic treatment of the organoids, we examined the expression profiles of the stem cell markers from the same six patients. We measured the expression over an increasing dose of 5-FU, and it was the revival stem cell associated genes, again, shown in the second row here, clusterin and UNXA1, which are the most significantly upregulated. So the revival stem cell, which as I described earlier, was identified in the mouse injury model and is capable of regenerating the intestine. If we take the results from our study, albeit in a small sample size, this suggested to us that this process of tissue regeneration that we observe in tissue injury appears to also be conserved in this model of human cancer. So we went on to then investigate if there was any other evidence that might point to a role for these revival stem cells in chemo resistance or tumor relapse in colorectal cancer. And to do that, we accessed publicly available databases, including the TCGA database. We examined survival and disease recurrence in publicly available databases for patients with colorectal cancer. And this showed a significant correlation between high clusterin expression with both lower survival and an increase in disease recurrence. So taken together, this suggests that the revival stem cell may indeed be a useful prognostic marker in colorectal cancer. So conclusions from this study and future directions that we're looking at moving towards based on the outcomes of this study, we showed that patient-derived tumoroids are a relevant in vitro model for studying the heterogeneity of stem cell populations as represented in the primary tumors. I didn't show you all that data today, but there's more of that in the paper if you're interested. We showed that there is considerable variation between individual tumoroid lines in the repertoire of stem cell markers present. We identified that clusterin is a marker of the revival stem cell population, and it is enriched in tumoroids that are also resistant to 5-FU treatment. Overall, patient data showed that clusterin correlates with lower survival and an increase in disease recurrence. And moving forward from the study, we're actually trying to use CRISPR technology, which is a gene editing technology, to knock out the clusterin gene in some of our tumoroid lines to determine if we can then sensitize these more resistant tumoroids and retest them with a chemotherapeutic treatment to see if we can induce a response. So with that, I would just like to acknowledge the co-authors on this study, And the two teams led at Monash by Helen and at Cabrini by Paul, and also to acknowledge our funding bodies and also the patients who generously donate their tissue to our study. Thank you.
Fantastic, Rebekah. Thank you very much. So in terms of what do you use to actually identify clustering? What technique?
We use a variety of techniques. So we can, we're trying to establish an antibody in the lab. We're having a little bit of difficulty in terms of specificity. But for this study, we were using PCR, so primers for that gene to amplify up and analyze clustering in that way.
So if you are able to identify an antibody, you could potentially do immunohistochemistry.
Yes, exactly. Right? Yes, that's what we're trying to do at the moment. We're in a testing phase. We've got a few different antibodies from different companies that we're working up to try and make that an established protocol.
And secondarily, you showed us some data about resistance to 5-FU. Sure. Have you tested them against the other chemotherapeutic agents that are active in colorectal cancer?
Yeah, each of those lines will have been tested with 2 to 3 minimum different types of different combinations. So they will have been tested with FOLFOX and FOLFIRI type regimes as well.
Yep.
And for the most part, we do see similar responses to those 5-FU-based combinations as we do to 5-FU alone. So, yeah, those patients that are resistant to 5-FU are resistant in general.
Yeah, no worries. Okay. Well, listen, thanks very much for the presentation. As always, outstanding work, and we love that you work with us. So thanks very much.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Good on you. No worries. We are now going to move on to our third presentation, which is our presentation from Tom Rozbroj. Tom, I think, is on the line somewhere. And Tom is a postdoctoral social researcher at the Cabrini Institute in Monash University, and is interested in ways that publics and patients understand and accept and use information about health and healthcare. His topic is how do patients and the public understand over-testing and over-diagnosis, a thematic meta-synthesis of qualitative research. So over to you, Tom.
This project's really all about reducing low-value care. Just some really quick definitions, although I suspect most of you are familiar. By over-testing, I mean tests and screening which lack clear benefits, and over-diagnosis, I mean a medically indicated diagnosis where it may cause the patient more harm than good. I'll refer to both of these as an amalgam, using the word overuse just to make the presentation a bit quicker. As you probably know, overuse tends to lead to overtreatment, which is treatment that can do more harm than good. So there's some good reasons to try and reduce overuse. Obviously, by definition, it can harm patients. And there's also a whole bunch of reasons around, overuse wasting healthcare resources, such as human resource, finances, access to equipment, and so on. And the Cabrini is, of course, committed to value-based care, so I would argue that it's an important topic for Cabrini specifically. I think a more interesting question is why tell patients and publics about overuse? We do have some evidence showing that when you tell people about overuse, it helps them avoid being overdiagnosed and overtreated, and it leads to better clinical interactions with healthcare providers. But I'd like to argue that there's actually a broader imperative here around shared decision-making, because in many cases, people are being asked to choose whether to take up a particular test or treatment, and there's risks and benefits to both taking the treatment or refusing it. And often it comes down to a value judgment, a judgment based on personal preferences. So we really need to give people the information about all the risks and all the benefits in order for them to engage with their healthcare decisions in an informed manner. There's quite a lot of research being done to try and reduce overuse, and we're just a small piece of that. So we're doing, our research is all about understanding how lay people make sense of overuse. And it's a multi-component research project. And the bit that I'm talking about is really the first piece where we wanted to know what existing research tells us about how people understand overuse. So that's currently under peer review, and it will fuel further work to do our own primary research and ultimately design interventions to reduce overuse. I won't go too much into the methods just because I really want to focus on the findings and the implications of those findings. But if you're interested in the details of what we did to do this synthesis, I'd encourage you to check out our open access protocol and BMJ Open. So we looked for any qualitative research about how patients or the public understand overtesting or overdiagnosis. We searched for databases back in March 2020. And out of a bit under 3,500 records, we ended up finding 25 that met all the inclusion criteria. But we only synthesized 21 of those because 4 of the studies contained no relevant results, so there was no point synthesizing them. The analysis really had 3 parts. So we wanted to work out how good the individual studies we were synthesizing were. Then obviously we want to synthesize the studies. And finally, we want to work out how good our own synthetic findings were. The actual synthesis had 2 layers of analysis. The first was a thematic synthesis, which was really about aggregating the main overt ideas into data. So an example of that is, you know, lots of people are saying that they found screening and testing to be hugely valuable. So that might become a descriptive theme. But then we also did an analytic synthesis, which is really about understanding the ideas behind the themes, right? So if people have high faith in screening and testing, what's behind that faith? You know, what ideas make that possible? What underpins that confidence? The analytic themes is quite risky because you're relying on subjective interpretive processes, but you get high reward because you can really go deeper into the data, and you're really leveraging the strengths of qualitative research, which is going beyond just systematizing ideas and answering the kind of why questions. Oops. Now I want to talk about the results at 3 levels. The first level I want to talk about is just the kind of studies that are out there. So the 21 studies we have show that, you know, there's some really wonderful research about how people understand overuse, and particularly out of Australia. There's also some limitations to the work I'd like to point out. All the 21 studies came from high-income countries. Most sampled women, and most of those women were highly educated. Most focused on cancers, and almost all used fairly descriptive qualitative designs. And I think they're all gaps because we have reason to expect that overuse happens in lower-income countries, but we don't know much about it. In high-income countries, we would expect that people from culturally and linguistically diverse backgrounds experience information about overuse differently, but we don't know much about that. And we really need explanatory data, right? So why do people interpret overuse information in the way that they do? So having a body of research that largely uses descriptive qualitative methods can only take us so far. The next layer of results I want to talk about is the descriptive synthesis results. And I think these are quite intuitive, so I'll fly through them. We found 6 descriptive themes, which showed that people have a huge amount of confidence in screening and testing. They found information about overdiagnosis and overtesting quite difficult to understand, but actually participating in the studies and reading the information that they were given in the studies did help them understand those concepts to an extent. There was a broad acceptance that overuse can be harmful to people, but there was equally a broad rejection or problematization of overuse messaging. And that was anything from people just saying that, you know, overuse as a concept is rubbish, or that's just motivated by saving money, to people accepting that overuse is real harm, but saying that we shouldn't do anything about it because early detection is so important. Generally, the studies showed that overuse information had pretty limited impacts on changing intended test and screening uptake. But across the studies, people really wanted more information about overuse, and they wanted to have discussions about it with their healthcare providers. The final layer I want to talk about is the analytic results, which I think are is the exciting stuff, at least for me. So we found that the descriptive results were underpinned by two sort of undercurrents. One was a belief that information and information gathering is inherently good and inherently valuable. And this really underpinned the beliefs around testing, where testing was seen as an objective information gathering process that then enables medical decision making, right? So you get the test and you work out what you're doing. It wasn't really considered as something you do medical decision making about. And so this idea that you have to really think about whether to get the test, whether to get the intervention in the first place, or that getting the test can actually lead to harm, was really hard for people to make sense of. I'd argue that there was a similar mechanism behind the desire for more information about overuse. So despite many people rejecting or problematizing overuse or not wanting to use the information, they really wanted to know about it. And I think it's part of that same mechanism where you get the information and you work out what you do with it. And we saw across the data that we synthesized that people had a lot of confidence in using health information effectively, which in the overuse literature isn't necessarily borne out in the research. The second undercurrent was that lay people really understood overuse concepts and the interaction between overuse concepts quite differently to experts. I think the first two points are somewhat intuitive and already borne out in the descriptive themes, where people understood overuse concepts partially, and they accepted them partially. But the interesting thing was that they understood the causality between overuse concepts quite differently to experts. So experts will tend to look at overtesting leading to overdiagnosis, leading to overtreatment. And the idea is that to reduce overtreatment, you need to start with reducing overtesting. Among the studies that we synthesized, it appeared that people believed that overtreatment was the real thing they needed to focus on. And they believed that information about overtesting and overdiagnosis would allow them to avoid overtreatment while continuing to undergo testing as normal. So that kind of causality that experts see was broken among the publics that were in these studies. I think all this, the synthesis has some important implications about how we talk about overuse with the publics. I think it's really worth thinking about what we mean when we say that we need to talk about overuse with publics and patients. The kind of messages that we put out about overuse aren't necessarily the messages people are hearing, and that was borne out in the synthesis. Messages get reinterpreted through the prism of experiences, expectations, and beliefs. And really, we need to understand these prisms and work with them in crafting overuse messaging. We really need to be granular in the kind of messages that we put out, because somebody that's just been diagnosed with prostate cancer is going to require very different communications about overuse and have very different attention spans and scopes for engaging the information than somebody who's about to undergo a PSA test, let alone the public who, you know, is part of a general awareness campaign, where I would argue that, you know, communicating concepts like overdiagnosis and overtesting might be a bit too ambitious. And instead of talking about these concepts, we should really be communicating a mindset like every medical intervention has risks and benefits. You need to ask about those risks and benefits. How you assess those risks and benefits against your personal preferences. So it really shapes the kind of goals that you have, right? You don't necessarily need to explain concepts like overdiagnosis. You can be communicating mindsets. You can be shifting assumptions. And the takeaway here for me is that we really need to be flexible and open-minded about what it means to talk about overuse. I think the other implication is that's going to be really tough to get people on board with messages about overtesting and to a lesser extent about overdiagnosis. It is possible to communicate difficult ideas and counterintuitive ideas like overtesting, but it comes at a big cost, right? Those communication strategies are much more difficult to execute. And I think we should be really thinking about whether patient-centered strategies to reduce overtesting are a good value proposition. We know that people find overtreatment much more salient. And I still think we have a duty to tell people about overdiagnosis and overtesting. But perhaps we should think about whether other levers to reduce those phenomena may be more effective than trying to do it at a patient level. Finally, I think we should be careful about interpreting research that says that, you know, people want to know about overdiagnosis as impetus to do patient-centered strategies to reduce overdiagnosis. Because as the synthesis has shown, people are really predisposed to want more information. But the synthesis shows that the desire for that information has a limited translation into a desire to do something about overuse. And we really know very little about how desire to do something about overuse actually translates to action. So I think there's a degree of caution to be exercised there. Overall, this was really the first synthesis that I'm aware of that examined this, synthesized research about how lay people understand overuse. And although we use data that's already out there and published, doing the analytic synthesis really allowed us to go beyond the existing knowledge. So it's quite an exciting project to be on. And it's going to enable us to do some really great stuff in tailoring communications and moving the research forward. So yeah, I'll leave it there. I think I'm out of time and I'll take any questions that you may have.
Thanks, Tom. That was really good. It's a very difficult area, I would assume, to be able to discuss with individual patients, in as I think a lot of decision-making relates to ingrained beliefs. I'm going to ask you a sort of question out of left field. One of the biggest areas that we see is not so much in overdiagnosis, but if you talked about the complementary medical field and complementary medicines and the billions and billions of dollars that are spent by patients on that, if you can't convince them not to do that, I can't understand how we're going to convince patients not to have tests if someone recommends they do it.
Yeah, absolutely. And Tom, to do justice to your left field question, I'll give you a left field answer. So
good.
My previous research was in vaccine acceptance, and that field really shows how evidence has a really limited role in informing patient decision making. You know, you're relying on heuristic experiences. And I think the CAM field, you know, complementary and alternative medicine space, really bears that out. But you don't necessarily need to counter beliefs with facts in order to get people to do more evidence-based things. So there's a whole bunch of tools we have to communicate, whether that's, you know, appealing to emotion, appealing to personal narratives, just getting people to ask better questions. So while facts have a limited role in persuasion, there's still a lot you can do.
Glad to hear that. Well, listen, I think we are out of time. So thanks very much for the presentation, and thanks to all the speakers today for another excellent session. And I will see you all in 2 weeks. So have a great day and have a terrific Easter, everyone. See you later.